Welcome to the CCI Bootcamp. Okay, so before I start CCI Bootcamp, okay, let me introduce myself. My name is Akshay Hegde and I'm here for handling network automation. Okay, so I handle network automation, DevNet related course like DevSec, DevCore, all this automation stuff I handle over here. Okay, so as the session goes on, like from now onwards till the network automation ends, I'll be the one who will be taking the session for you guys. Okay, later on there will be different trainers who will be there for some other technology concept. Okay, so from now we will be starting the automation part. Before I start the automation part, can you tell me, like, do you know about what is CCI basically? Anyone who knows, like, what is CCI?
Internet work expert level.
It is the expert level.
Cisco certified expert intermediate.
Yeah, internet work expert. Correct. So when you go for CCI, okay, when you attempt for CCI, previously it was like you should know about basic networking, like you should be a CCNA certified or you should be a CCNP certified in the core exam. Correct. So now the things have been changed. Okay. Yeah, I will be providing the recording to you. Whatever things we record in this session, I'll upload on the Google Drive and I'll give you the access of Google Drive. Okay. So don't worry. All the recordings will be provided to you for automation. Whatever things we cover, I'll be recording them and I'll be just uploading on the Google Drive and I'll share you the link. Okay, so I was talking, like, when you appear for CCI exam, you have to, like, before it was like you have to go for any core exam that is in CCNP and then you can just attempt for the exam. Okay, now if you see CCNA, CCNP and CCI, this CCNA and CCNP, we just assume like it is an entry level exam. Okay, it is very much different from your CCI exam. So anyone who are here who has just who is a CCNP certified?
Yeah, I am.
I did
CCNP
security.
Okay.
I have done routing.
Okay, that's fantastic. Like, most of the people over here.
I have done CCNP.
That's very good. So most of the people over here have done like CCNP. Okay. So now you know, like, the scenario in CCI is different as compared to CCNA and CCNP. Because if you see in CCNA and CCNP, we just have the MCQs type of question. Correct. We just have the MCQs type, multiple choice questions, which were. But if you see in CCI exam, you don't have multiple choice question. Okay. Firstly, if you want to write CCI exam, you have to write the written exam of your core track. For example, if you want to do routing switching, that is, you have to write the NCORE exam. Correct. The concentration exam, the core exam. If you want to write the security exam, then you have to write the security exam over there. Correct. The security core exam. So these are the prerequisites which you have. Guys, please be on mute if you have nothing to talk. If you have any doubts, only that time unmute yourself. Otherwise, be on mute. Okay. So as I told you, your CCNP and CCNA exams are basically, they are like your MCQs type of question. Okay. Yeah. We go for CCNP core exam, which we call. Okay. But if you see nowadays, you just have to go with the concentration exam, that is the written exam, and you can appear yourself for the CCI lab exam. So when I talk about CCI exam, it is basically the lab exam which you are doing. Okay, whatever troubleshooting it will be, or whatever design you have to do, those all things will be the practical thing. It will be like the it will not be like the simulation, but it will be like the real-time scenario. Okay, you will be having the real world scenario which you have to solve. So that is nothing but your CCI lab exam. It's all about your CCI lab exam. Okay, please stop drawing on the screen. Please stop drawing on the screen. Okay, so that was about CCI lab exam. So now I'm here to handle the network automation part. So anyone knows what is network automation? Have you heard of network automation?
Doing the automation configuration via automation.
Basically, if I try to explain what is network automation, it's like we have two things in network automation. First is that the network programmability, and the second one is network automation. Now, what is network automation and network programmability? Basically, they are nothing but whatever we used to do on the CLI, that is the traditional method, while we do how we used to do the configuration on the routers and switches. This is just an advanced way. Okay. Now, if I tell you guys, you have to configure VLANs on 10 switches. Okay. How many time you will be taking to configure VLANs on 10 switches?
Based upon the VLANs.
Okay, let's suppose
VLAN, 1 or 2 minutes.
Let's suppose I'm saying you have to create 200 VLANs on 10 switches. How many time you will take in real time production?
It will be one line command also. If we are going through the secure CRT, we will open 10 switches same time, and we will put one command to the execute every switches.
Okay, so how many time it will take?
If it is one line command, it will some in second.
No, I don't think it will be in second. If you go to CRT,
it is a time consuming
method. At least two days.
No, not at least 2 days. In 1 day you can do, because I just told you to do 10 switches. So you can just write in this format. If you have, you can say VLAN 10, 20, 30, or till 100 or 200 you can go, correct? So it is actually time consuming, but not that much time consuming, okay? Hello, guys. Please be on mute if you don't have anything to say, because I'm getting background noise over here, which is just it's disturbing the class over here. Okay. Now, as I told you, if I want to configure 10 switches, okay, I want to configure 10 switches and I want to create 200 VLANs over here. Now, how much time I'll take? I just told I will be taking like around, just suppose I'll be taking 1 day over here. Okay, but do you know, by using some scripting method over here, I can just create this VLAN in 10 seconds. Have you seen this thing? Okay, over here we use Python. So through Python, what you can do is you can just create 100 or 200 switches or 100 or 200 VLANs on 10 switches at a single instance. So you don't have to wait an entire day over here. Okay, that is the power of your network automation.
But sir, to write a script again, it will take time.
Okay, well, that's a good Python question. Script. Yeah, that's a good question. So if you write a script, that is one time investment, correct? You just have to write the script only once, and you have to run it multiple times. Okay, now if I write a command, if I write a script which will be used to create 200 VLANs on 10 switches, do I have to change that script in the next part?
Required, I guess.
Not required, correct? If your day-to-day life is just to create VLANs on different switches over there, is it required? No, right? It will be not that much required. If required, you just have to change minute changes in the script. You have to just do minute changes in the script rather than going to the user from the user execution mode, then to the config enable mode, then to the config mode. So this is like time taking, correct? Now, as I told you, only one person cannot do the configuration on 10 switches at a time, correct? But if I use automation scripts over here, I can do it in a single time, correct?
Okay.
Okay, so that is the advantages of network automation. So over here we use Python script, okay? Plus we will be studying about APIs also. Do you know what are APIs? Application Program Interface.
Maybe it's connects with the backend of automation script.
Yes, sir. We should connect the switches via these API, just like a secure CRT. We can also access
the mediator between Python and switches.
And this is nothing but for the interoperability purpose.
What for? What purpose?
interoperability API purposes, connect right? API connect two different applications.
Correct.
Okay, so yeah, exactly. Well, just be on mute now. Just be on mute. Okay, now API is nothing but it will be a connection between one client and a server. Okay, if you have a client and server, there will, to have a connection between client and server, you will be using APIs over here. That is nothing but a application programming interface. So your APIs are nothing but there are some logics which you have created. Okay, based upon the logics, it will be working. For example, let's suppose this server is nothing but your router. Okay, this is a Cisco router. I'll just make it as 1900 series router. Okay, now you want to update the iOS version of the router. So if I want to update the iOS version of the router, how can I do? I can do via TFTP server. Yes.
What do you?
Yes, guys. If I want to update the iOS version of this router, yeah, I can go with TFTP server. But you know, right? For TFTP server, what I have to do? I have to create a client. Okay. On the client machine, I have to give the IPs. Then on the other end also, I have to give the IPs. Then the router and the device should be connected with each other and should be in the same subnet, correct? So this is like a very time taking. But if you create an API which will be doing your work, then you don't have to worry. So in APIs, you will be having just JSON scripts or some other scripts which will be in the XML format. Okay, over there you will be writing the logic how you have to just change the iOS version on the router, and you just have to send the API from client to the server. So we have some tools over here, such as automation tools, which will be helping you to do these tasks, such as we have Ansible, we have Puppet, we have Chef. Okay, have you heard of this thing? Ansible, Puppet, Chef?
Yes.
Yeah. So these are the network automation tools which we'll be using to just automate the stuff over there. Okay. Now, yeah. Now the next thing over here is how to create this API. Okay. Now to create the API over here, we will be using Postman. Okay. Now Postman is an application interface where you can just create APIs. So whatever API you want, you can create it through Postman application. So just let me show you the course agenda, like what are the different things which we will be covering in your network automation part. So in the network automation part, we will be studying about Python. Does anyone have a familiar now has worked on Python before?
Yes, I have.
Okay, so have you worked in networking perspective?
Yes, sir. I work on Netmiko, Paramiko, NC client, NetConf, and stuff like that.
Okay, NetConf is a protocol, and Netmiko, Paramiko are the libraries.
Sure,
okay. Okay, so APIs are nothing but it's an application program interface. So it will be basically like an. Okay, I'll give you an example about API. Okay, now let's suppose you guys go to a restaurant. Okay. And when you go to the restaurant, you will be ordering your favorite food. Now let's suppose there is no waiter who is present inside the restaurant. What you have to do is you have to go to the chef. You have to tell the chef what order you have. Okay. According to that, the chef will be preparing the food over there. So this is, don't you think it is very complicated and time consuming and very hectic? Because always you have to go to the chef and you have to mention your order, like what order you have. Correct. So that is really time consuming. Okay. So what we can do is rather than creating load on the chef itself, what we'll do is we'll assign a waiter over there. Now what waiter will do? Waiter will come to your table. He will take the order. Okay. He will take the order to the chef and he will process it. Now, according to that, what you will be getting a food which will be served to you. Correct. This is how your APIs will be also working. So basically you will be having a client and a server. Okay. Now if you want to access any data from server or if you want to access any data from client, you have to use APIs over here. Now through the API, you will be sending the data. Understood the meaning of APIs?
Yes.
Okay.
Sir, can we say it is the bridge between client and server?
Very good. It is a bridge between client and server. It will not be a bridge, but it will be acting as a bridge. Yeah. Just it will be like an intermediate who is just helping a client to communicate with a server over here. Okay. Now then we have REST APIs. Have you heard of REST API? Request and response. Anyone? So basically, let's suppose you have a client over here, okay, and you have a server over here. Now this REST API, it works on your HTTP protocol, okay? That is your hypertext transfer protocol. Now what your REST API will be doing is, see, APIs are nothing but the application program interface. So you can send APIs in two way, okay? First one is the REST API, or you can send through netconf, okay? RESTconf and netconf, these are the two things which will be studying in the coming session, okay? When I talk about REST API, these are the APIs which I will be using over the web browser, okay? These are the APIs which I will be using over the web browser. Now when I send a request to the server, let's suppose this is the server, any web server, okay, from where you want to access any information. So what you will do, you will send a request, okay? Now after receiving the request, what the server will be doing? What the server will do?
Yes, server will respond. So I'll like to add something to it also. When we had an issue last Tuesday and it was working for Vijay, so that time his connection was going through this firewall and I was not able to see any logs for him.
Okay, so when I send a request to the server in return will be giving me a response. So this request and response are nothing but they will be done through the REST API. Okay, I'll show you one example over here. Let me go back to my screen. Okay, can you see the web browser over here? Yeah, so if I go to cisco.com, what I'm doing is basically I'm trying to access cisco.com over here, correct? So when I hit enter on cisco.com, I'll be getting, okay, I'll just try to reach the server over here. So in return, I got some output. Can you see some output over here? Okay, can you see the output over here? But can you see the state, the server has given me some response over here. What is the response? It gave me access to the web server. But if you go over here in the developer option, more tools, developer option, if you go over here, okay, and if I go to network over here, okay, if I go to network over here and if I just give enter again, can you see I'm getting some output over here? Can you see how many requests are generated over here at the bottom? Can you see the request number? So these are the requests which I'm getting over here. And can you see the status over here? That is 200. Okay, so we will be studying about the status code also. So over here, when all the connection is proper, we will be getting a response code of 200. Okay, 200 means everything is fine. Then we have 300 for redirection. Okay, we have 300 for redirection. Then we have 400 for server side, client side error. Then we have 500. So we will be studying about those things also. The next thing is data encoding format. Okay, now what is encoding?
Encapsulation, sir.
Yes, it's a type of encapsulation. So basically, let's suppose you have two PCs over here. Okay, I'll just name this as PC1 and I'll just name this as PC2 over here. Now when you want to have a communication between PC1 and PC2, okay, now you just have connected both of them and you just want to have a connection between them. Okay, let's suppose over here, when PC1 tries to send any data to PC2, but there is some condition over here. Now your PC1, he only understands things in C program. Have you heard of C program?
Yes.
It's a programming language, sir. Correct? So what PC1 will be saying is, okay, so I can only understand whatever things are in C program. Okay. But what PC2 will be saying is, okay, I just understand the things which are in Python. Apart from that, I don't understand anything over here. Okay. Now, can you see a language barrier between them? Now, is it possible for these devices to communicate with each other? Can they communicate with each other now?
No.
No, right? Because one of the PC, he only understands C program, and one of the PC, he only understands Python. So there is a language barrier between them. Okay, now they cannot communicate with each other. This can be routers also, this can be switch also, this can be ASA also, any device over here, access point or any device. Okay, so over here, when they talk in the through the web server, there will be a difficulty over here. Okay. So what we will be using is, we will be using some data encoding format. Okay. Now, what are data encoding format? Data encoding formats are nothing but you will be encapsulating the data into the required manner. Okay. In the required manners, in the sense, whatever type or whatever language you understand that will be common to both of them, you will be using that type. Okay. So I'll just give you an example, like we will be using JSON over here. Okay. Now JSON will be understandable by your PC one, and JSON will be understandable by your PC two also. Okay, so that's how the things will be working over here. That is in data encoding format. So JSON is nothing but it is JavaScript object notation. It is a derivative of Java. Okay, JavaScript. It has been described from the JavaScript itself. Then we have XML. Okay, have you heard of XML?
Heard, but don't know. What yeah. It is
so basically XML is nothing but it is a extensible markup language. Okay, it's a type of markup language which you will be using to send the data, same like JSON.
Okay,
but the structure is different over here. Okay, JSON, the way you write JSON script will be different, the way you write XML script will be different over here. Yeah. Okay,
then so what is the difference between HTML and XML?
HTML you will be just like using to write the website. Okay, but XML is just like your HTML, but not like HTML. Okay, now what's the difference is, HTML will be used for designing, correct? Just to see the output, just to display something. But XML will be used to carry the data. It will be used to carry the information. Now let's suppose you want to push some configuration to the router. Okay, you want to push some configuration to the router. So what you'll do is you'll just create a logs. Okay, you'll just create a document, a Word document, which will be having just a startup configuration. And through XML, you will be just sending the data to the destination or to the server. So over here, this JSON, XML, YAML, YAML is nothing but yet another markup language. What these things will be doing is they will be acting as a transport medium. Okay, they will be acting as a transport medium. No, it's not just like a translator. Okay, it will not convert C language into JSON. It's like we are just sticking on the language which we know. Okay, for example, yes.
But both devices, how they come to know that JSON language, both devices?
Because this JSON, XML and YAML are the web-based language, which is present in a web server.
So
if you go over here on the web server, so on the web server, your JSON, your XML, your YAML, all these things will be, the compilers will be present over here. So you don't have to worry about that. Okay, these things we'll see in practical in the coming sessions. Okay, from tomorrow when we start the actual class, like all the scripting related things and all, that time we'll see the thing over here. Okay, so that time all the things will be clear for you. Sounds good?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Yeah, then we have Python libraries. As someone discuss about Netmico, they discuss about Paramico. Okay, then Netconf, Resconf, these are the two protocols. Then we have Napalm, all these things. Okay, now what are these libraries over here? So libraries are nothing but we have some built-in modules which are present inside this library. Okay, now if I talk about Netmico, has anyone used Netmico before?
Yes, I have, sir.
Okay, Mudassar, sir, can you tell me like what exactly a Netmico does?
Sir, it actually is SSH the device and simplifies the configuration task for us.
Okay, so basically what it will be doing is the Netmico over here, it will be creating a SSH connection between your device and your PC, correct? Because if you want to push any configuration from this PC to the router, you need someone who will be doing the connection, correct? Now, when you use Python over here, the scripting language, you have to use either Paramico or you have to use either Netmico over here. So these are the two things which you can use to just push your configuration to the router. Let's suppose you want to create 100 VLANs, okay, on a switch. You can just use Netmico and you can just run your Python script. Or let's suppose you want to enable OSP on your router. Okay, you can just do that thing also. Or let's suppose you want to just take the backup of your startup configuration. Now, can anyone tell me, like, how do you take the backup of startup configuration?
Sir, via Python script?
You can.
No, via just normally, like how you just take.
We can go through one guy
at a time. Okay, just hold on and tell. Yeah.
Via
FTP. Correct. Okay. If you take FTP, that means again you have to create some connection which will be done. Okay.
Yes.
Then any other method?
Yeah, just putty log we can save. Right? The
Through the command the copy run also startup config.
Directly saving into the local system with the
sir, also there are tools which actually doing the backups like SolarWinds tools.
Okay, that's nice.
We schedule the task and these type of tools on the scheduled time access the device and take the backup.
Okay, very good. So I can see like multiple people are having multiple solution, correct? But if you see all the solution is just like time taking. Okay, you just have to log into the device, you have to create servers, you have to just configure the client, you have to install some software over there, correct? But if I tell you like through Python, I can just take the startup configuration backup within second. Just I have to mention the router IP address, then the SSH information such as the username and password, and my work will be done. You will just get the document in the text format. Don't you think it's easy?
Yes, sir.
It's very bit easy, correct? So we will be studying about that also. We have some other tools also, but when we talk about network automation, we have to stick to network automation itself, correct? So we have to see things which will be related to network automation. Okay, so those all things will be come under your Python library. Okay, like if you want to push any configuration, if you want to see any update, or if you want to change the iOS version, all these tasks you can do via your Python libraries over here. Okay, now this thing, whatever we talk was about network automation, correct? Sorry, it was all about network programmability. That means through some scripting or through some any other scripting method, we will be doing the automation task. Now when it, okay, what is the advantage of Netmico over Telnet library? So can anyone tell me like how do you use Telnet library in Python? You use a command that is import system, correct? The one who just asked me the question, Temitop, yes. Are you there?
Yeah.
Okay, just guys be on mute. Let me answer him. Okay, hi Temitop. Okay. How
yes,
are you doing?
I'm here. Fine.
Okay, so your question was what is the advantage of Netmico over Telnet library? Okay. Yeah, so have you used Telnet library before?
Yes, I was able to use Telnet library with my ifng. It comes by, yeah, with ifng.
Okay.
So luckily it comes with take Telnet library by default.
Okay, so just can you answer my one question?
I've used it before.
Yeah. Just answer me. Which one is secure, Telnet or SSH?
I've not used Netmico before.
No. I'm telling which one is secure. Is it Telnet or is it SSH?
SSH.
Yes. Everyone agree? SSH yes, is secure. Right.
Yes, because
whatever username we give in SSH, it is more secure, correct? Because we use RSA key generation over there, correct? We use crypto RSA to encrypt the data. But if you see Telnet, is it a secure connection? No, right? Whatever information you give, it is in the clear text form. So that's the one reason why we will be using NetMeeko over Telnet library. Okay. Yeah. Second reason is when you configure Telnet, you have to use multiple function over there. Okay. I can assure you that Tabitop, when you do the Telnet configuration via using Telnet library, you might have been use a long script, correct? Like importing system, importing OS, correct? Then importing date and time. All these things you have done, correct? Then all the your script will be like it will be like around 20 to 30 lines code. That will be very time consuming, correct? Over there you have to just call the objects. You have to use many objects there. But when you use NetMeeko over here, in NetMeeko, it's just two things which you have to keep in mind. First one is just importing the library. Second one is just to create a connection, okay, by using connect handler. That's the advantage over Telnet library. Understood, Temito?
Yes, I understand it now. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, one more question we have. Just a second, guys. In network automation, Python will be taught how to write code or it get it from GitHub? No. First, basically, as I'll believe like everyone is a fresher in Python. So we will be starting Python from scratch. Okay, you don't have to worry about Python. We will be studying Python from the scratch. So we'll just go, we'll just have a hands-on grab on the Python. Then we'll go to the next part. So once we are done with the Python, once you can identify like what are variable, what are tuples, what are list, what are objects, what are functions. After that, we can jump onto the scripting part. Okay.
Sir, can I ask one thing?
Yes.
Sir, if we have Parameco, then why NetMeeko we are using?
So how you and, use Parameco?
Also one thing more, when we are using NetMeeko, so for the scheduling, we have to import scheduling libraries, and for the time, we have to import time library.
So, yeah, exactly. So not, no, no. NetMeeko is a derivative of your Parameco. That means NetMeeko is more stronger than your Parameco. Okay, when you use Parameco over there, you have to mention the device type which you're using. Correct? You have to mention the device type over here. But in NetMeeko, do I have to give that specification?
No, not the specification of device type.
Yeah, we just have to give the iOS information, correct? Whether it is of Cisco, Huawei, Nokia, Juniper, Palo Alto, like
that. NXOS, yeah.
We have to give in that way. So if you see what difference are there, we have multiple difference, okay? But as you know, NetMeeko is like perfect as compared to Parameco. Then we have one more thing that is known as NAPAM. Have you heard of NAPAM? It is also a Python library which we can use, okay, to push some configuration to get and device update and all, so that we can use over here. So don't worry, once we are like having a hands-on grab on the Python, then we can move to the next path. Okay, any other doubts?
Data parsing also will be covered in this session.
Data parsing via using JSON and XML will be doing.
Okay, but not via NTC client.
No.
NTC not, template.
No, you are talking about NCC?
Yeah, NTC templates.
No, we will not cover that one because that thing is not covered in a syllabus. If you want to like, if you want to have more information related to network automation, you have to go for like a DevNet course, because a DevNet course is fully dedicated for your automation. Okay.
Sure thing, sir. Sure thing.
Yeah. So I have one more question over here. That is, does it work in HP router as well? It failed for me. Yeah. Your NetMeeko will work for HP router also, if it is having the functionality, if it is having the module, that time it will be working. Yeah, this course is for enterprise. Okay. That is basic routing and switching, your CCI enterprise course. So, but in enterprise also, they have introduced automation, like not fully, not in detail, but just the beginning of automation. Because as you know, like all the things are just getting automated nowadays. So we have to go on. We have to just step ourselves into automation.
Well, Akshay, this is Shashank.
Yeah, Shashank, hi.
I posted my question. I tried it telnetting and creating a loopback interface in HP router with the same script which I used for Cisco. Right. I did the basic tweaking, like just command line was different. So it didn't work in HP, but it worked in Cisco.
Does it
require some more tweaking for a different vendor?
Basically, it's like, see, if I want to have a communication with any of the device, I should know the root of the device, correct? Now, if you are talking about Cisco, Cisco is like a very famous vendor, correct? So all the libraries, they will be having modules which will be supporting on Cisco. But HP routers, I don't think so, like everyone will be using. So I think in the telnet part, there will be lack of modules in for HP. So that's the reason you're getting that error.
And about NetMiko, if we are using NetMiko, it would be same?
Yeah, it will be same. Just when I go to the NetMiko library, I'll just show you what are the different things you will be seeing in NetMiko. I'll tell you the installation also, don't worry about this. We'll cover everything from scratch. So let this thing get loaded. Okay, my notebook will be opened over here.
Sir, what is this Jupyter Notebook actually?
It is a IDE where you will be running your Python code.
Like Ubuntu or something like that?
No. Ubuntu is an operating system. It's like a notepad, but with the Python compiler. Don't worry. When tomorrow I'll be starting the things, I'll just give you an information. Okay. In detail, I'll explain. Today, I'll just give you an overview. So when I use NetMiko over here, I have to give a command that is import NetMiko. Then when I give directory of NetMiko, can you see, Shashank, there are different things over here? Now you told for HP, correct? So we don't have, yeah, we right. have for HP also.
Okay.
So NetMiko will support your HP device also. But what you have to do is you have to just correctly use the function. Then your work will be done.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Any other doubts? So we don't have any pre-requests for building automation lab in our laptop. What requirements are like you should have EvenG in your system. Okay. Then you have to just, you should know the basics of Python. That's it. And you should know like how to do the connectivity. That's it. We don't have anything else over here.
But sir, if we want to work with NetConf or RESTConf, then I don't think NetMiko is enough. We have to go for NC client.
Yeah, we have to use NCC client over there. Okay. So see, if you go in detail, automation itself is a huge topic, correct? For example, see this, whatever we talk, it was about scripting time, correct? You have to write script. But have we discussed about the tools which you are going to use, like Ansible or Puppet or Chef? That also are not in your syllabus, but I'll be giving an overview like how these tools will be working. Okay, for example, can anyone explain me like how SNMP works? If I have a topology over here, okay, and I have to just implement SNMP over here, can you tell me how it will be working?
Sir, there are three parts in SNMP. One is manager, one is the agent, and one is the MIP. So actually manager.
Okay, let's make this system as manager.
Manager, yeah.
Who will be managing the network over here, correct? And let's make this switch as agent.
Agent, right.
Okay, so agent one, agent two, and agent three over here. Okay, sorry for my bad handwriting.
Very bad, sir.
Yeah, exactly. So I'll just write in short form. Agent one, agent two, and I have agent three over here. Okay, then tell me what is the next step.
And there is one more thing, which is MIP.
So basically, management will know polling from all the agents.
Okay, so management.
At regular periods, intervals.
So what manager will be doing is, manager will be telling like, okay, this all switches, that is agent one, agent two, agent three, you have to, like, I will be the one who will be fetching the information, correct? I'll be going on the SNMP monitor and I'll be just seeing like, what is the clock rate over here? How much CPU has been consumed? All those information. Okay.
Yeah. And the agents can also send traps also whenever any link goes down or something.
Okay. That can be seen in SNMP version 3, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. But don't you think it's a little boring over here? Like every time you have to go to the device or you have to go to the agent and you have to just tell the agent, okay, give me some information over here, provide me information, whatever you think, whatever thing is going on, just give me that information. Don't you think it is like little boring over here?
No sir, it's not boring. It's automatically performed at the back end. So how it's boring?
Okay, I'll tell you one thing over here.
Like BRTG or tools like that.
Okay, so we have one more thing over here in automation known as model driven telemetry. Have you heard of model driven telemetry?
No, sir.
Okay, now modern driven telemetry is nothing but over here. This is the best thing if you want to interact with your device. Okay, for example, if you want to interact with agent one, agent two, agent three. This is the best thing which you can use. So now what model driven telemetry will be doing is, it is having one thing that is known as subscriber. Okay, we call it a sub. And it is one more thing. It has one more thing that is known as publisher over here. Okay, now over here we have a client machine. Okay, this is a client machine you can call, this all three. And this will be the remote machine over here. Okay. Now what I'll do is, I'll set policies on my clients over here, that is on my agent. What I'll say, okay, in every 5 minutes, you have to give me the CPU update, or in every 10 minutes, you have to give me this update, whether it is in the form of graph or whether it is in the form of Excel sheet. Now, can SNMP generate data in the Excel sheet? Yes. Can SNMP develop data? Can it generate data in the Excel format? The data in the Excel sheet?
No. It will not.
No, we cannot get, correct? You will not come to know, like, let's suppose over here you have some routers. Okay. You have some routers. Now, if you have any new neighbor which is connected, or if there is any issue in the link or any secondary, oh, sorry, any primary path is down, can you get any update of that thing? No, right? You cannot get updates of those things while you use SNMP. But when you use model-driven telemetry, you will be getting information about all those things. Okay. So this data you can just keep in the graph format. It can be in the Excel format. Okay. You can just create a logs over here based upon the time. So that is the advantage of your model-driven telemetry. Plus, this model-driven telemetry is so powerful. It is so advanced. That through some technologies, like you, through some scripting part, what you can do is you can just tell the device how to correct the error. Okay, it can just, based upon the policies which you create, it can just auto correct the things which go wrong over here. As I told you over here, I have subscriber. The subscriber is nothing but how we subscribe for the YouTube channel. Correct? We go to some YouTube channel. Let's suppose we have Netflix on the YouTube. Okay, they also have the channel on the YouTube. Now you click subscribe, you click on the bell button, correct? Now when you click on the bell button, you will be getting the updates. Now from whom you will be getting the updates? From the publisher. So over here we have subscriber, over here we have publisher. So publisher will be publishing the instances which are happening over here. Okay, that is how modern driven telemetry works. Okay, got it.
But is this like a new tool or new software or something?
It's a new software which is like purely dedicated for your network automation. So just understand one thing, when I talk about network automation over here, if you compare it with CLI, that is the old traditional method, you were the one who was going to give instruction to the devices, correct? You, on the basis of your instruction, the devices used to work. correct? If you say the device, you have to go from this line. Okay, the device will go from this line. If you say from this, you have to go from this line, it will go from this line. Okay, but when you talk about network automation, over here, your device will try to communicate with you. Okay, it will just try to create some information on its own. Correct. So that is how network automation works. Basically, what you will be doing is you will be just having a communication with the device over here. Got it?
Yes, yes.
Yes.
Okay. So this model-driven telemetry, I can see one question related to it. Which platform tool solution are you referring for model-driven telemetry? So it is nothing but the Cisco ASR9K. That is a model-driven tool which you can use. Okay. When we come to that part, we will come to know in detail. For now, just I'm giving you an overview here.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now then we will be studying about Git also. Have you heard of Git? Git?
No, no sir.
Sure.
Yes, it's a version management tool.
Okay, it is a version control system, correct? So basically, why do we require Git over here? Now let's suppose we all, like there are 92 participants over here, correct? So we all are working in a same project. Okay, we are under one same company and we are working under same project over here. Now let's suppose when we write a script which will be used to do the BGP configuration on a service provider, okay, we have to work on the same thing, correct? So that means whenever whatever script each and every person is writing, please be on mute. So whatever script we are writing, it should be seen to everyone, correct? Like if I'm writing any script and it is not seen by Mudassar, it will be not the correct thing, correct? So what we will be doing is through Git, what we will be doing is we will be creating a repository. Okay, on that repository, we will be doing the scripting part so that each and every person can work in the team. And if any changes in the code or any changes in the script happens, it will be known to everyone. That is about Git. Then we will be studying about Ubuntu also, like how to configure Python on Ubuntu, how Python will be working on Ubuntu. Those all things also we will be seeing for you. Got it? So guys, before I wind up, okay, today is just an introductory session, so we'll not start the actual part today. From tomorrow onwards, we'll start Python.
Sure, thank you.
Okay, so I'll just stop over here. We'll meet tomorrow then.
Thank you so much.